Eu sei, o jogo é duro, mas o futuro é no presente que começa. Se a gente jogar direito, haverá jeito de poder vencer a peça. Pensa, mas não procure desavença. Saiba marcar sua presença na hora da decisão. Pensa que um desatino não compensa. Sei que a vontade é
Hello, how are you? Good afternoon to all of you who are watching us in Brazil, and good evening to those of you who, like me, are in the United Kingdom. My name is Tamara de Paulo. I'm an educator and a master's degree student in education and development, international development with the British a scholarship from a British government, United College of London. I would like to thank all of you who have made this event possible. Haddad Foundation, IDEA Big Data, the law firms Matos Filho, PGMBM, and Natura & Co. Thank you for believing in this project and making this event possible. We are located in Shoreditch, East region of London, and this region is famous for breathing art, culture, and youth. It is not a coincidence that we have chosen this space to host this event. Behind me, you see these historical walls. They are over 150 years old, and there is a train that rides above us, and you can hear any of that, but this inspires us to talk about the history of Brazil. We've had 12 panels with different topics, and let me just review those with you. We had a panel about climate crisis and environmental justice, traditional populations and human rights, digital transformation, pandemics and income, gender violence, gender against the Black population, conspiracy theories, sustainability, environmental sustainability, new tests for Brazilian politics, the role of cultural manifestations for social transformation, and this earlier today, why is there so much visibility to LGBTQI plus people? And at the same time, so much violence inflicted upon this population. So it's necessary to question ourselves, if Brazil had quality education, public education of quality, should we have different paths? So I would like to then start the last panel of the Brazil-UK Forum, and it's with pleasure, with great pleasure that I start this panel about education and social inequality in Brazil. And I would like to introduce then our team of professionals who are going to debate with us. So I'm sorry, I lost my dot. So I just want to make sure that I follow the script. Welcome, Professor Denise Carreira, who is a master's and a doctoral trained at the State University of São Paulo. She's engaged in feminist, anti-racist, and student educator, providing visibility to marginalized groups for social justice in Brazil. She's an activist for over 30 years. She's been working in promoting race and gender equality all over the country. Since 2018, she's been amongst the Brazilians who is a part of the Humacai Fundo Malá, what it means, I have learned today. Fundo Macai is the space in which Malala used to write about the realities of women in Pakistan and the difficulties they had in having access to education. Hence, Malala, then we know what happened to her. Denise currently integrates the coordination of the Coalition for Rights Are Worth More and a critical articulation of public policies for economy that defends a new economy that is committed with human rights and financial rights. In order to add to this panel, who is trained and he's got a master's in economy and a doctor in philosophy by USP. He was the mayor of São Paulo and minister of education in the Lula's government. She was the candidate for the Workers' Party in 2018, and he's the author of 5 books. Though he has followed a political career, classroom settings have always been a priority, always committed with an ideal of transformation. And other professors just like me, the day after the elections of 2018, they interrogated him and asked him, what are you going to do now? I'm going to go back to my classroom. It might be a very simple sentence, but for people like me who are always an educator and who had a very difficult time during the elections, it was inspiring and it inspired us to continue. And last but not least, I would like to say welcome to Rosana Fernandes. She's a master's in territorial development in the Caribbean, and she's a doctoral student in education. She is a coordinator of the landless movement in Goiás, and she's the head of the Florestan Fernandes School, which conjoins practices and politics. This is the way to close event. I am so happy that you have made this possible. So in order to start more or less how this conversation is going to go, we are going to have 3 different sets. First, we're going to think about education, critical education, and the importance of this education in Brazil. Then the dichotomy between meritocracy and inclusion, and then the impact of the pandemic in education. We have seen for a while now a significant advancement of instrumentalization or weaponization of education in issues regarding transformation of education, which means we have been sending students to school in such a way that they are not critical of themselves and their society around them. But they are only being trained to be in the job market. So then I would like to ask Professora Rosana, who is head of the Florestan Fernandes School, who is employing an education that seeks to promote freedom. So what is a school? What kind of model is that? Good afternoon, Tamara. Good afternoon, everybody. We've been following from Brazil and the United Kingdom. Good afternoon, our comrade, Fernando Haddad, an educator. It's a pleasure to be here. Educadora Denise Carreira, our mediator, and all the team who organizes this event. Alexandre, we've been in touch. And also, Emanuele and Chile, it's a pleasure to be here in this round table representing the Florestan Fernandes School, talking about education and Brazilian society, is also to denounce historical processes that the Black population and Brazilian people have been enduring, and the exclusion over the history of Brazil. We know that education has undergone historical, relevant historical moments over the history of Brazil, and that each of these historical moments have been placing needs in terms of interventions according to these historical moments. We have gone through imperial and the colonial republic, and then the republic, and we had urgencies in terms of decisions and programs so that the population could have access to education. And we evinced in this process, particularly in this last period of the Brazil and education, I would like to remind you about the intense work of Anísio Teixeira as one of the pioneers of this new pedagogy that combated the restriction of schooling and education to the elite. And from his struggle in 1991, education then is organized the way it is nowadays to a certain extent with some changes, both the primary and basic and high school and the schooling being mandatory until 14 years of age. Anísio Teixeira, then we owe him this recognition. And we also need to advance in this process and talk about an education of freedom. And we need to mention Paulo Freire, who proposes this project of popular education, and that is proposed by Paulo Freire, that we recognize as a popular movement in the country. We know him, and he builds a pedagogy that goes beyond school structures and beyond acquiring literacy of their sounds and literacy of words and sounds, but an education, a popular education that elevates the awareness of people so that a method of dialogue and problematizing reality may build subjects that are promoting transformation of reality that he is or she is experiencing. This knowledge, this acknowledgement of Paulo Freire for his 100th birthday, and many activities that have been organized in this name in his praise. So Paulo Freire comes to bring and remind us of the need so that we have, that our society may have a freeing education, an education that is posed in training subjects and providing education to subjects in society, emancipating these subjects. And then the landless movement among the many experience that it has been developing in the last years. Many schools in the settlements, public school education, public school settings, but since the beginning, we have looked after the front and the struggle for public schools for people who live in the country. And now we have approximately 1,800 schools in our settlements, in these territories. We also have many activists who have access to institutions of higher learning through a program of agrarian reform, a pioneering program. And under these circumstances, it has been under attack through budget cuts, along with other public policies related not only to education, but particularly in issues of agrarian issues, but also in issues regarding partnerships with municipalities in the interior of this country. The MSC, therefore, constitutes a way of educating from a standpoint of schooling, but from the experiences in its activism, the political and ideological training, education, in order to maintain strong in its educational purposes. And we may also state that the National School for San Fernandes is an example of a school that allows this for this education and this training in broad human ways and in integral, full-time or a full approach, and it builds from the working classes in Brazil, Latin America, and the world. We develop here processes of educational training through courses and beyond the rigorous training of an educator contributing to this process. We also have dimensions that go beyond classroom settings that are placed as work, as educational principles and references in rural education, in art and culture as a way of life and not about mass culture. We also have the experiences of mystics in a project that allows us to think that it's possible to promote the changes that we seek to have in such a way that there may be participation of those who are receiving education in these organizations. And that also reflects as we try a freeing model of education, the praising Florestan Fernandes, our late Florestan Fernandes, who is an inspiration, so that the landless movement recognizes this legacy as someone, a subject who has persisted, who is coherent with the revolutionary spirit. And this recognition is not only in terms of issues of gender and class, but because he has not denied condition of where he came from and being what he was in terms of witnessing from a theoretical and practical perspective, the profound exercise of recognizing his origin as part of structures of social inequality, cultural and political inequality in Brazil. So we believe that honoring and recognizing his legacy and at the same time introducing what it means to have a school such as the Florestan Fernandes school in order to enable a possibility of new educational framework seeking to promote freedom of in Brazilian society. So we are trying to bring Florestan Fernandes, Anísio Teixeira, and Paulo Freire in order to contribute to these reflections about educational inequalities in our country. Thank you for mentioning them. It's interesting that in my master's degree in London, it is a mandatory reading to read Paulo Freire. But if you talk about Paulo Freire in Brazil, people are going to find it strange. So this is the global north, and we are reading a Brazilian author who has a mandatory reading. And in Brazil, on the other hand, we need to have more understanding of what he stated, because very little is known about what he has done in contemporary Brazil. Professor Adagi, we've had a research idea, Big Data, that was developed specifically for our forum. And they have interviewed people, over 1,200 people over 14 years old. And we asked, how is it that we can address issues of socioeconomic inequality in Brazil? The majority stated that a basic public education would be the best way of addressing inequality. So we see incredible projects, as the one Ana has shared, being exploited, being utilized all over Brazil. So we have successful projects in Brazil, all over Brazil. So why don't we have projects like this on a nationwide scale? Is there, in fact, willingness from the part of the government that people wouldn't think critically, or is it a lack of management? First of all, I would like to thank for the opportunity and greeting Denise, Rosana, Tamara, our interpreters who are translating us for sign language. I wouldn't state that we don't have a national project. Let me make that a relative issue in light of the following. I think that Brazil did not have a national project of education until very recently. In fact, I would state that the Constitution in 98 was the first landmark, but I think also that we started to develop programs that currently are under threat, but who that configured a national project. Let me provide you an example. Fundeb is an essential component of the national education. It's state government money in order to provide resources for impoverished regions to ensure basic education. It provides them support from kindergarten until basic education in high school. The government currently, through this constitutional amendment that has transformed this as a permanent policy, it's going to be a support 20% of the sum of all the money that comes from states and municipalities. And I think this is part of a national project. You see, from 2005 onwards, it's been an interesting year because we created the IDEB, and the IDEB measures the educational development of all public schools in the country. And learn, I believe that those who were more impoverished had were then there was an improvement in their educational quality. That doesn't summarize education, because education is much more than doing well in mathematics and Portuguese. However, wouldn't be a good sign if people don't dominate some fundamental languages to all disciplines, all other disciplines. Learning Portuguese, if you don't learn Portuguese, you won't be able to learn history, geography, and from some levels of complexity. So it demands a certain understanding of languages. So when you expand federal universities and federal institutes and the broadening of we are talking about a national project as well. We are talking about quality, we are talking about funding, we are talking about permanence on retention rates and our graduate courses. 50% of our knowledge production in Latin America comes from Brazil. And since we were the last in the continent to create institutions of higher learning, I think that, however, we can't compare ourselves to the United States because very few countries may be compared to the United States, but we are the 13th in knowledge production in the world, and women produce 40% of this knowledge. 50% of these students are currently Black, and these numbers were frightening and shameful. 68% are now coming from public institutions. They have finished school, and now there are 68% of teachers or faculty or students in institutions of higher learning. So I could spend so many hours explaining this question, addressing this question, because I was a minister of education for 7 years. So then we wanted to have a national plan that would only be on paper. Anis Teixeira was the first one to sign the first educational plan in 1932. So he was a pioneer in terms of providing an educational plan, dealing with professional education, institutional higher learning, funding quality, catering to professors, valuing professors. I'm talking about a document that is going to be now, it's 90 years when this document was published. So there were enough projects, and I would say that in the end of the 90s and the beginning of the century, we've had at least 15 years of good educational projects that were signaling something more organized. And then the political crisis you are aware of have started in 2015. The country started to be institutionally fragmented, and that has affected dramatically education. We have now our fourth minister of this government, and it has no direction. The future yourself was geared towards federal universities, and 63 universities did not adhere to this program, and militarizing schools is complete nonsense. Instead of organizing our schools, which are the real troops, we start to then improvise with notions that have no empirical evidence of functioning, nothing working under nothing. Universities are under siege in terms of its administrative pedagogical autonomy. The INEPI is being dismantled, and the concerns are big in terms of what's happening at CAPES, INEPI, FUNDEPI, not to mention the secretariats in the Ministry of Education, in which you see people who don't have enough preparation, particularly to deal with the post-pandemic issues. People don't have an understanding of what's going to happen to the school deficit that we are going to face. Precarious education has been offered over the last year, and retrieving that, this is going to be a tall task, and it will demand people who are very committed with educational training. Nobody is going to, it's not going to be the type of work that is going to render votes or visibility, but if nothing is done, we are going to have tremendous losses for the future of the country. And I would like to add that without basic education for all, of course, we may not, as Paulo Freire has stated, education is not a panacea. That Paulo Freire had a well-known sentence that's been cited and recited. When he stated, look, if it's not true that education resolves the issues of the country is not going to be able to resolve its issues without education. That's the sentence, more or less. So, but that's the sense. So education is a foundation. It's a condition without which, condition, a sine qua non condition. And we need to understand that a nation involves developing education institutions of higher learning, quality of life, and urban and rural territories. It involves cheap credit and a number of other issues that should be coordinated, because we are not only educators, we are workers, we are biological beings. We need food, we depend on pure air or oxygen and potable water as biological beings. We are not only poultry. We have materials and other needs. So those who are looking at those, the workers and landless people and the destitute and impoverished people, it's a project that needs to be, I think we need to repeat Paulo Freire as one of the most important educators in the world. He was able to understand that education is a necessary condition for overcoming any type of challenges for the people, individuals who are emancipated, are an emancipated nation, and that involves much bigger complexities, and then placing all the weight in institutional policies in one aspect that needs to go beyond. Thank you for this overview. You have actually gone all over our script about these affirmative actions that should be developed. And we are also going to talk about the pandemic because it's impossible not to mention it, since this is a pressing, very pressing issue for us. And I wanted to talk about a political article that you have crafted in the International Magazine of Human Rights, in which you talk about the importance of the white population in combating racism. And we have legislations that force, make mandatory to teach Brazilian, Afro-Brazilian and African history in Brazil, but as the majority of this body of professors are white, correct me if I'm wrong, but what I see in your text that we need to, as a white population, to record our histories and change our behaviors in classroom settings. So correct me if I'm wrong and explain to us why education not only needs to address issues of race, but also of gender and class. Thank you, Tamara. First of all, I would like to thank you, Tamara, Patricio, Malícia, Cláudia, Raquel, Emanuele, Silvio, Luke, and all those who are organizing this forum for the opportunity of being here and the importance of the political organization of this forum. I would also like to salute Rosana for her trajectory and her commitment to our country. And it is important to state that this institutions that are involved with educational rights, we have been experiencing in the last decade a notion of what it means, quality education. All the people who want to talk about quality education, but the perspective of those who are more meritocratic, answers of to the interest of the market, grounded on the principle that inequalities are an issue that corrode democracy, corrode our planet. And the key question is, what is the notion of educational quality that Brazil needs in order to face our profound inequalities, the authoritative legacies and environmental destruction, and this patriarchy culture that marks the lives of so LGBTQ plus population? What kind of quality education is necessary so that we don't only build but sustain our values of racial and environmental equity? What kind of notions do we need in order to protect our country from these authoritative adventures like the ones we are living right now? This notion of social quality is necessary, and it goes beyond what goes beyond what is captured by DEB, which is the main educational index in the country. I'm talking about an educational quality that allows for developing meaningful learning, critical readings of the world, as Rosana has stated, accessing and reinventing scientific and humanistic knowledge in a democratic culture that should be enrooted in daily life and its dimensions, a democratic culture that overcomes social issues, recognizing human rights of all people, stimulating indignation and against racism and inequalities, that this only this week has killed another black teenager, Kathleen, confronting fundamentalisms and stating a real commitment among people. History of educational policies in Brazil are marked by white fear, the racism of white elites that has denied for centuries the rights of a population that which is formed by elites that during many years are then still segregated in white spaces, in public, in private schools, and consequently they then deserve low quality education for democratic means. I'm talking about elite schools that are considered high quality, often offer low quality educational framework for democratic purposes. It's not possible to educate children and teenagers for democracy in environments that are segregated for white teenagers, who at most are going to be related to black people in subaltern positions, affirmative actions that have been under attack by the Bolsonaro government should be present in all institutions in the country, not only in terms of a policy of reparations, but in also building a democratic culture. Hence, that's why we are intervening in our plan of basic education. This legislation has been approved by this current government in a plan that is predicted the national project of basic education. The SINAEB has had a normative legislation that has been dismantled right after the institutional coup d'etat of 2016. And this proposition was geared towards confronting inequalities and building a culture that was going to be effectively promoting equality. One of its main tasks is to broaden indexes in terms of what it means to have quality education in our country. And that's what I want to bring up. What is the quality of what we need to in order to overcome everything we are living, enduring? And therefore, we need to have a quality education that is committed to the promotion of human rights. That's it, Tamara. Thank you. Denise, your lecture has been harsh but necessary. So following up on our questions, we are now going to talk about democracy and inclusion and education and inclusion. And I would like to bring up a personal example so that we can exemplify the question that I'm going to have you address. We talk about the privileges that we have, and I know that many people get offended when they hear this type of comments, and privileges is not, it's not, there's nothing wrong with that. So me as a condition of a master's degree student, I know that I have deserved to be here, but at the same time, it's because I had a foundation, my basic education was private, that allowed me to be in a public institution of higher learning. I had emotional support. I had the necessary structures that allowed me to be where I am. And believing that everybody had the same chances that I had is oversimplifying and it's ignorant. So then when Haddad was a minister, he promoted many types of affirmative action policies as a departing point to promote a more equalitarian country. The ProUni strengthened the FIES. He created the IDEB and other support programs. And unfortunately, what we see is that there are many people who do not need these benefits, but benefit from them, not to mention those moments in which it's not even utilized. And then I would like to ask Haddad, when you were a minister and you had this project in mind, what did you imagine that would happen? Where were these policies that would be necessary? How did you see the implementation of this public policy? Tamara, you know that when we came to the Minister of Education, I started as an executive secretary. I was then a vice minister, and then for 7 years I was a minister. So we had over 3 million university students in the country. It was shameful. A country of 200 million people, 3 million university students, and now Brazil has 8 million. And the goal of this national plan of education, because the government is not, the current government is not promoting anything towards that, which should be reaching the goal of 12 million people. Because from 3 million to 12 million, we had already overcome important barriers. We didn't have the strength to have a completely public expansion. Those who more expanded public institutions in Brazil, the public institutions of higher learning tripled in size, particularly federal ones. But in order to fulfill this goal, to establish partnerships with private institutions of higher learning, community institutions, and we created the ProUni with that goal in broadening the national plan for education, because that was not originally a resource coming from the Ministry of Education, and we wanted to use new resources in order to broaden institutions of higher learning without compromising the expansion of these institutions, and it was accomplished. These affirmative policies, CISU, was something. If someone took the name next to their homes, and then there's a whole presence of over 1,000 seats available in federal institutions. In the past, there was the National Plan for Educational Support that would ensure a retention rate. You could be impoverished in Bahia, and you could study in Rio Grande do Sul, and vice versa. And many people now use territorial mobility in order to move across the country looking for better educational opportunities. As we know, there's now a serious compromise to this program, because during the pandemic, we don't understand yet what's going to what it means in terms of a post-pandemic scenario. But this issue that you have mentioned, first of all, what was on our mind? The first question you asked. There are two historians that I enjoy very much. One is Benedict Anderson and Eric Hobsbawm. You might know both. And both of them refer to the historical process that was in formation of grand nations. And both are coinciding, asserting that a national project, an authentic, legitimate, genuine national project is only forged and using an impoverished person goes to a university when the lowest layers, the most economically destitute, get to an institution of higher learning, that's when they start to produce the type of knowledge that establishes a dialogue with the whole nation, and that you have an exchange between the university and the community that goes beyond extension courses and that encompasses research. So research, extension, and teaching is guided towards a national project because the nation is there. And I've always had on my mind since I read this text that was unavoidable. So what is basic education. Impoverished people go get into the university is really important to the development of the country. For economic reasons, he or she may not be outside of the university, and talents are democratically distributed. It's not through income or talent. So you have talented, impoverished black people, women, talented women. And if Brazil wants to use their best critical mass for a national project, it has to be available for everyone. Another issue of the fraud, sometimes I hear people who are committing fraud in SPS and Prouni, and sometimes an institution that have learned any expedient to take advantage of the national treasury. As much as we have, I'm going to continue to charge taxes, though some people may not pay taxes. So as an inclusion program, in the case, because of a minority that is going to like to take advantage of it, you are going to create mechanisms to prevent fraud. And these mechanisms are very viable. You may effectively have a control, big control. The support for families we could not imagine that this financial aid for impoverished families would have become what it did. We control the attendance rate for students. Just imagine having 50 million people attendance rates in my computer. I had those attendance sheets in order to pay people or tell people to go back to school with children and to justify their absences. Sometimes they were sick, sometimes they were migrating. We have people who work with sugar cane. There's assassination. It's a very violent country. So we fine-tuned the control of all of this. But we will never be able to understand that these behaviors of deviant behaviors may justify the lack of action of these families. What needs to be done is to control it. Good public policies are implemented and controlled, and there's no obstacle that prevents us from drawing more and more improved forms of control. And secondly, we need to think about education from a systemic perspective. We had a slogan which was from the kindergarten to graduate school. And somebody then in the World Bank said, what is your priority from kindergarten to graduate school? And they said, it's impossible. I said, no, it's not possible. It is possible. Because if we had the budget to back that up, in real terms, it has tripled. And it's gone 5 times bigger. You are able to accomplish that. You are able to do that. And it's also untrue that everything may be revolved with management. You have to have more resources and more management. I don't like this binary thing. It's institutional, basic, or high school. Ask that in France and watch to see if anybody's going to answer that. Is it basic? Is it superior institutions of higher learning or professional? Is it, what do you mean? It's the whole package. There are people, there are countries that stand beyond the national average, but we are far from it. Let's have more resources and then let's manage it better and better, charge results. All of that is very correct from the part of constituents to demand from the state what it has done with the resources, and we need to develop a project that has beginning, middle, and end. I miss it so much to have a Ministry of Education that cared about education. Oh, I just feel so much like I do miss my former president. So if we were to talk about national policies in public culture, aside from an education and sanitary crisis, it's also political. Well, Pamara, we are undergoing a terrible moment. Education is one of the most affected areas by this authoritarian wave that has hit our country. It may sound absurd, but the Bolsonaro government has a project for education. As we had stated here, talking about the project, but what was the project by Bolsonaro? Ultra-liberal, against rights, but it's a project that is coordinated and is coherent in dismantling the advancement of public policies in the last decade. And in the National Plan of Education, establishing goals until 2004, it is a project that cuts off educational policy budget that come in deregulating in accelerated ways several of these institutional achievements, and that has ended several programs that have confronted educational inequalities. Adade has mentioned some of them. So Bolsonaro's government wants to implement an educational project that predicts the expansion of the presence of private institutions in harm and in detriment of public institutions, and it predicts redirecting educational policies for obedience, education for obedience, you know, an order that was going to be more and more equal, sexist, racist, LGBTQ phobic, violent, an order that preaches hatred towards impoverished people and those who are considered different, obedience to a hierarchical society that seeks to dismiss thousands of people, naturalizing the genocide of indigenous and black populations, and an austerity policy, economic austerity that will continue further concentrate wealth in the hands of a few. And in order to sustain such the inequalities and contain social conflict, it's necessary within the Bolsonaristic logic, an education for obedience. And what's proposed in home education, which is a priority for his for this government, it seeks to confine teenagers and students so that they are educated according to religious doctrines and political doctrines. And homeschooling is part of a broader intervention, educational intervention, seeking to militarize schools, catering to ultra-conservative frameworks, stimulating persecution to professors and education, basic education in professionals. It is also formed by legislations that seek to prevent debates about race, gender, sexuality in schools, and the advance of religious intolerance in educational spaces, for multiple attacks towards affirmative action, racial affirmative action policies, and in prohibiting educational content that addresses the issues of inequality. And there's also a text against the National Program for Didactic Books and the criteria so that the rules produced for the editorial market in the country wouldn't address issues of inequality and racism and homophobia. But aside from that, in spite of that, we have organized civil society that has been resisting this project. We've had important achievements in the Supreme Court last year, overturning legislations inspired by the School Without Party movement, and a lot is being made in order to prevent these authoritarian regimes, but the struggle is very unequal. At the moment, we need to broaden debates in Brazil in terms of what is at stake in this project for education and mobilize even more international solidarity in order to prevent this fascist project and the authoritative moment in Brazil. It's a very challenging moment, but it's fundamental that we have spaces like this so that we can broaden the public debate in terms of the threats, facing these threats, and what is at stake in these circumstances. These are very disheartening data, but it's good to know that we are not going to give up and that we are facing these challenges in the best ways we can. The next question I would like to pose here, I want to talk about the pandemic, but I think we have enough context to talk about it. From 3 to 5 children who have lost their school year in the world live in Latin America and the Caribbean. And I would like to know, according to this research and your experience, how do you evaluate this data and why do you believe that the majority of the children who have lost the school year are located in this region of the world? Thank you, Professor Haddad. It's good to hear you and Professor Denise because you have brought several elements. I was actually thinking here about how I could include some elements to this debate. Since you have also stated the issues related to your experience within the context of inclusion and meritocracy and thinking about the subjects that are now praised to Florestan Fernandes, I would like to bring an example from Florestan Fernandes in the context of thinking about meritocracy and all the popular leadership at MST and my personal experience in how to. I am in full agreement with what Professor Haddad has stated. We are not here defining what should and should not be done, if it's children's education or institutions of higher learning. We are just reasserting that we need to have the budget resources that should account for the demands of our society. So in this example, Black Florestan, he ends up his basic education efforts. And in 1941, when the university, the State University of São Paulo, he then joins this effort. So what it means for a working class young person who spends his whole basic education making efforts, immense efforts in order to deal with his education under the adverse conditions to study and to join a university such as USP, which is a public university, but we see it as one of the most elitist universities in the country. So this experience by Florestan lets us know that in this dislodging of trajectories that has been developed, it undergoes, and this suffering is a suffering that is not physical, but it endures consequences of an educational model that is placed in our country, that places us as working class people light years behind in terms of what teaching institutions have been constituting itself. And it is a bit about this feeling that we now have when we look at the quotas programs in institutions of higher learning, which is, they are very relevant and necessary. And I think that's what Professor Denise states. In order to guarantee, let's put it that way, but it is a suffering in terms of how we are placed within these institutions of higher learning. So I take this example of Florestan in order to state that even though the struggles of in terms of education, we should historically then, in this example by Florestan, until now it continues to be a territory in dispute, specifically from access and permanence of working class groups in institutions of higher learning, not only them, but also particularly in ensuring access and permanence of in a trajectory, the school trajectory, and basic education, and so on. We have at MST from an articulation with other movements, if necessary. MST has a practice that is well recognized, but there is an articulation of several working class movements that build in the country, education in the country. And one of the struggles that have been organized by this education has to do with what I have mentioned, the PRONERA, the National Educational Program in Agrarian Reform, that has allowed in thinking about institutions of higher learning to allow many activists from the movement to study in order to better contribute to organizations as educators that we are. However, PRONERA, in the space of the country side, it's being extincted in light of budget cuts, which means that achievement from 1998 until now, two decades later, we are undergoing the risk of extinction and being less of a possibility for working class people to be at university settings. So looking at the experiences of popular movements in PRONERA and thinking about a project of a society that MSC has no doubt about asserting and continue to reassert as a project, a socialist project, that would be ideal for our country, even as we understand that this is far away from happening in light of this historical moment that we also are enduring. But there has been, and we have the expectation that in popular experiences in the federal government, that we may place education as one of the first tests, first goals, so that we may place in the hands of the people this tool against ignorance and alienation, which is to be able to elevate our level of awareness for an education that goes beyond the structure of a school. It's necessary that educators are also operating within this perspective of a new subject. We also understand what Denise has already stated about the educational policies that are placed at the moment for the field, this unmanagement beyond what is the concentration of land and monocultures as a way of production, are also bringing issues regarding this topic, because there are corporations intervening in educational policies also in the field, which means that we are then, there is a dispute in the territories. We need to advance in this confronting, this accelerating of merchandising educational on all levels that have also become an agro-business goal in terms of the movement all for education. We have many examples we could provide here, aside from the campaign on school materials that have been already cited here. And in conclusion, we also, in specific issues of the education in the countryside, we have been struggling against closing education, closing the schools in the field, because aside from all these structures that are also important, there is the closing of existing schools in the field in the country. We have been searching that between 2013 and in one decade, that's been 37,000 schools have been closed in this field, and this is a very large number under the conditions because of the exclusion that has been imposed upon these people, education that takes away these children from school, not allowing them to have their educational training, aside from the terrible conditions of transportation, meaning putting at risk the lives of these children and teenagers. Hence, this issue of closing schools during the pandemic. We also have a reassurance that this campaign, going back to this closing schools in the field, is a crime, in the country is a crime. And then we are resisting. I think that's the best and strongest word that we have been using as of late, in resistance of ensuring the least we can lose under our current circumstances. We are not advancing, we are actually resisting, in the sense that we have been trying to maintain what we have achieved. Many losses have happened from in terms of the achievement of rights, but we haven't even talked about the losses of life and what it has mean in terms of naturalizing the death of many Brazilians. We have been reaching over 500,000 deaths, which means a lot for our society in terms of what this moment means, and that has left a mark in the history of Brazil in terms of the whole, but particularly for the lives that have been lost. So why have these lives have been lost? And then out with Bolsonaro has been unifying the country, but we need to take the streets, because words alone are not going to be enough. Thank you for your speech. It's very inspiring to know how many efforts have been made. And we are now going to address our last question, which is a question coming from the public. I would like to ask you to address that question briefly. What is the future of education as we look at the current crisis in Brazil? Professor Denise, 2 minutes to address this question. Mariana, thank you. First, I would like to state that I would like to highlight the importance of debating the economy. The circumstances of our education are very affected by a constitutional amendment 95, because we are undergoing this dramatic moment of the pandemic, but Brazil, aside from the sanitary crisis, has been undergoing an economic and political crisis in light of this austerity policies and the budget cuts, the economy has been one of the areas that have been then affected by these processes of democratization, and we need to think about what economy do we need in order to sustain a project of social environmental justice in the country. My understanding is that at the moment, the government has deepened the policies of fiscal adjustment. The 109 legislation that makes it more perverse, the austerity policies, because now that we need more resources in order to protect the population and to take back an educational policy that may confront the impacts of the pandemic, what we are undergoing are budget cuts from actually in funding the budget for educational needs and the conditions of schools. And it is within the schools that many children and teenagers and young people have their main meals, or the only meal. It is in the schools that these children then are asking for help in light of situations of violence. Aside from all issues regarding access to education, it's through universities and kindergarten, major portions of the population have access to their rights through schools. So it's important to put pressure on the National Congress in order to reverse the... We had 8 inconstitutionality interventions in this measure that in the United Nations, even Malala herself has sent a letter to the ministers of the Supreme Court asking them to judge this budget cut, because it's a measure that is destroying our educational system and social assistance, environmental assistance. We have elaborated a study and we have taken it to the Supreme Court about this budget cut. So the path is also going through organizing this debate and broadening public debates about the economy in confronting economic fundamentalism. Thank you, Professora Rosana, for your answer. Exactly, because that means that we are then going to lose a lot more than what it means in terms of the many things that students lose from being outside of school. Now, Professor Denise, if you could then address this question in 1 minute so that we can overcome these challenges. Professor Rosana, I'm sorry. Fine. I think that from this landscape in, that we have heard here and we have been living, which is more profound, our goal is not only for education, but for a hopeful future in which we can be able to address these many issues and challenges. From the experience of the landless movement, I don't see any other way, which is to maintain a permanent struggle. We cannot accommodate ourselves and we cannot lose hope. I think that this is this verb, to be hopeful, bringing once again Paulo Freire, is to keep this expectation alive and not to wait that something and that somebody is going to have a responsibility as a working class people. There is a political articulation in Brazil. We have made several initiatives, and I think that the pandemics have demonstrated the possibilities of unity in that in which we may be able to address this issue so that we may think about this popular project for Brazil, and that education is one of these fronts for our project. I think that we should not lose hope. And we will continue to struggle. So final considerations from Professor Haddad. Tamara, I'm going to go straight to the point because there's no other way out except for confronting the major issue. Brazil has two major problems now. One that I think seems to be the conjuncture in which we may then need to vaccinate students, but I see a major issue, which is Bolsonarismo, which is not Bolsonaro himself. Our society is impregnated with a vision of education that is very grounded on this negationism that we have been experiencing, this fundamentalism, something that is going to affect directly the quality of teaching. There's no closed education. There's no education that should be closed to science. Dogmatic education implies that it's medieval. It's everything that we have learned that should be overcome. Science advances with doubt and trial and error, and that's how humanity has been getting to know and overcoming its problems. And if we adopt this understanding pro-dogma and against science, we are going to wound education in deadly ways. Geared towards the beginning of our conversation, when we think about critical education and emancipatory education, critical education is to have an awareness that there is a method to measure physics, chemistry, biology. There is a way of looking at the world and teaching and learning, always checking and doubting your own knowledge so that it can advance. And this is has to do with modernity. Modernity, there has several issues, but this is not one of them. This is a merit that science has brought to the world and that it may advance. The issue of the state that embraces all religions or belief systems and all forms of life and protecting all forms of life and promoting knowledge, which is what matters to humanity so that humanity may advance, the dimension of values that go beyond morals, ethical and universal values that aggregate humanity and its principles, universal principles. And I believe that this is at risk in Brazil. And I see that next year, I didn't want to have to wait until next year because I think that the crimes of responsibility that have been evinced should be enough to remove any politician from any political party. But we are taking very big risks. And in fundamentally countries, and there are so many countries in the Middle East, in Latin America, and in Brazil, that have been adopting or utilizing taking step backs in which while the world are looking for critical ways of advancing, we are putting all the weight on setbacks. I believe we have many big challenges of a political nature because how are we going to end this, turn around the budget cut, because there's a budget cut that is geared towards specific issues. For what he wants to spend, there's cuts for education and health, but for the other budgets, there's no cut. So I think we are undergoing very serious issues, and the educational community Yes, but Brazil has not yet heard a positioning from educational communities. No, we are then going to be able to measure up the size of the damage that has been made and that needs to be curbed. I would like to then thank you all and thank you all members of the panel for accepting to participate in this panel. I'm very proud not only of this panel, but at the forum as a whole. And I would also like to thank once again for your availability and for your generosity. I'd also like to say that I, being the first generation scholar, I would like to dedicate this panel to my mom, who could not conclude her education, and my grandmother, who was not able to start it. Dona Kátia, Dona Marinetti, I love you so much, and thank you for thanking, for helping me make my reality very different from yours. And I want to honor all the education that you have passed along to me, and so that young people may be able to achieve spaces and change the circumstances of inequality of race, gender, and class inequalities that we have in this country. I would like to thank volunteers who have been working so hard since October, 8 months of hard work, the people who understood our messages, and all the sponsors that have made possible to make this forum happen in innovative ways. And we are very happy to provide continuity to this forum, and a special thank you to some women. Though we have 35 volunteers, 4 women really set up this studio and working hard so that this panel could be delivered to you in responsible and accessible ways. Claudia Alves, Mariana Nascimento, our coordinator and directors of broadcast, Vladissa Beckman, and myself, who's been here all week long coordinating logistics and organizing details. I'm very proud to have been a part of this project and defending education. I'd also like to thank those who are here, Emanuele Ressueção, Dinemar, Daiane Macaimbra, and also our English interpreter, Raquel de Souza, who is here also interpreting for you. I'm very proud to be a part of this forum and this panel. I'm very proud of my country. And tomorrow we are going to have our wrapping session with Luiz Roberto Barroso and Larissa Beckman, Dadara Werneck. Thank you so much and good evening. Rather, good night.